Why didn't Luffy awaken his devil fruit during the fight against Katakuri? Surprisingly simple answer to this one, he did. In fact, this wasn't even Luffy's first awakening. We have this tendency to think of devil fruit awakenings a bit like a light switch. They're either on or off. That's very much the impression that characters like Flamingo Man and Mochi Man have given us. However, other men also exist, such as Doctor Man and Junk Man, and their awakenings manifest themselves as a very specifically catered bonus power, new abilities that need to be honed and trained. And once mastered, Kid and Law may even be able to push their powers further and gain even more new abilities. Because if there's anything we've discovered with Gear 5th, it's that the potential for devil fruits is practically limitless. Another great example would be Chopper. Even in the early days of Drum Island, our drug-addicted reindeer was able to develop mechanisms to push his devil fruit beyond the transformation limits of standard Zoan fruits, eventually delving too deeply into the awakened monster form, and after the time skip, ultimately mastering the monster form. My proposal here is that the awakening of devil fruits is much less like unlocking the full potential of the fruit, and more like gradually ascending a set of stairs, with each new step granting a new ability, until you've taken so many steps that your powers are completely unrecognizable from where they began, and thus being deemed awakened. That's what I believe Luffy has been doing throughout the entirety of One Piece. Gradually awaken his fruit, going step by step, until it finally culminated in Gear 5th. And it all starts right at the beginning, which is the usual start place. And we're going to call this Step 0. After consuming the Gomu Gomu Nika Nika Nono Mimi, Luffy was plonked at the bottom of a flight of metaphorical fruit stairs. And to put it quite bluntly, most fruit users never go beyond the step. They consume their magical fruit and then they go, mate, look, I've got wacky powers now. And they very much resign themselves to the initial ability ceiling because they're lacking the most important thing that any devil fruit user needs, which is imagination. Something that Luffy practically has a monopoly of in One Piece, with no one coming anywhere near close to his wealth of imagination. Luffy is like the 1% of weird thought thinking guys. And if you want to be in the 1% of good looking guys, then head over to storeglr.com, featuring stunningly designed apparel, including Dog Flamingo Cat Akuri, Plant Justice Swamp Nakama, and the glorious Grand Fleet insignia. Each shirt comes in a variety of fun colors, a multitude of fun sizes, they ship worldwide, and they are printed on demand, on the demand of your chest to wear them. All of these designs were made by one of my wonderful channel artists, and after you receive your shirt, make sure to take a photo of yourself wearing it, and at me on Twitter for a chance to be featured in a Grand Line review video. Link in the description, so go do that, it'll be fun. But for now, let's keep talking about how Luffy had already awakened his devil fruit. And I find it so strange that a lot of people were put off by the wacky Looney Tunes nature of Gear 5th. I mean, put off might be the wrong way to say that, but I suppose that I was surprised that they were in any way surprised, because Luffy has been pulling this sort of crap since the very beginning. A great example is Arlong Park, where Luffy was heavily inspired by Genzo's pinwheel, and so naturally Luffy decided, hey, what if I, Luffy Man, were to become a pinwheel? Which he did when confronting Arlong, which was by far the most serious and emotionally charged arc at the time. And it showed us very early on that no matter how high the stakes are, Luffy is always going to do weird, wacky stuff. Such as on Alabasta, where Luffy was initially unable to overcome Crocodile's Logia powers. So what was the genius Luffy solution? Well, that was to use Gomu Gomu no Baku Baku to inflate his head and literally eat crocodile. Which, fun fact, I've also done that. You can eat crocodile in Australia, and honestly, it's surprisingly bland. I don't know, I think I was expecting more scales. However, Luffy's crocodile was far less bland than mine, as his food fought back. But this attack was also inspired slash stolen from Wapol, because Luffy saw Wapol eating literally all of the things and thought to himself, mate, that's absolute genius. Luffy may not be a pirate in many of the conventional ways, but when it comes to stealing, Luffy, mate, he is all about that. He sees something, literally anything, and decides to either use or become that thing. Probably the most original idea Luffy has ever had is the complete and utter absence of ideas when he used Gomu Gomu no Bo on Skypiea, countering Enel's observation haki by shutting down his brain and relying on raw instinct. And just like the pinwheel and the crocomeal before it, this technique was an abject failure. That doesn't mean there were bad ideas though, in fact, quite the opposite. At this point, Luffy had all the imagination he needed. However, his imagination was significantly outpacing his physical abilities. And this is an important factor in any self-development. Thinking ahead gives you a goal to physically work towards. And this is what I believe the key to awakening is. Luffy's relentless imagination continuously pushing his body to assume new forms and push the very boundaries of vaguely established rubber hood. To put it another, potentially more relevant way, Luffy did not have the freedom he craved. The world's greatest imagination was trapped within the limitations of a very rubber boy body. But that would all change during the Water 7 saga, where Luffy was smacked on the behind by the frosty fist of a Marine Admiral, and it finally became clear that Luffy's imagination and willpower alone was not going to be enough to complete this journey, which was the break that pushed Luffy to develop Gear 2nd and Gear 3rd, both of which are small glimpses into what would become the eventual power of Gear 5th. Gear 2nd introduces the element of steam, which would become a persistent feature of all future Gears, and Gear 3rd would introduce the idea of big, like really big boy rubber man boy. And this is the first real step of the Awakening Staircase. Luffy has now awakened two new abilities that were unavailable to him right out of the box, but we're still close enough to the beginning of the staircase to stay grounded, by which I mean that 2nd and 3rd have their own fictional scientific explanations. In theory, what Luffy does is speed up the blood flow of his body, providing it with increased oxygens and all sorts of delicious blood nutrients, which results in the heat and the steam. In fact, Rob Lucci did essentially accuse Luffy of doping, however the fight battle officials did rule in Luffy's favor, and so he maintained the win at any slobby. Again, it's fictional science, so it doesn't stand up to real world scrutiny, but it's our first step towards the outright insanity of Gear 5th, gradually layering in those absurd ideas that would eventuate in Toon powers. In a way, you could also think of Gear 2nd and 3rd as cracks emerging, with hints of Devil Fruit Awakening leaking out of them. And those cracks would become much larger during the timeskip, although we wouldn't be treated to the results of that until Dressrosa. Step 2 of the Awakening Staircase was the advent of Gear 4th, very much acting as a bridge between the more practical, sciencey gears and the bizarre religious iconography of Gear 5th. In Gear 4th, the once natural steam is now physically wrapped around Luffy, and with the Haki coating, this makes him resemble Neo statues, which are known as the Guardians of Buddha. And this is why Hyogoro compared Luffy to a guardian deity during the raid. And whilst it does seem more serious, I mean compared to Gear 5th, I can guarantee you that that was far from the reaction of the fanbase at the time. Gear 4th was actually surprisingly controversial back in the day, because it made Luffy look like a much less sleek and cool shonen protagonist, and more like a rotund beached Haki whale. And you know what, in world, even Doflamingo laughed at him and pointed out how ridiculous Luffy looked. But people were very quickly won over when they saw what this new form could achieve. And what it could achieve was punching Doflamingo a lot. And as for Doflamingo himself, well, after experiencing the fearsome glory of Gear 4th, he actually stopped laughing for the first time in his entire life. But Gear 4th was made possible through basic Haki mastery. Those abilities allowed Luffy's body to catch up to his imagination and push further, to become a lot more free, like a lot more, as we'll see in a bit. It also continues the theme of inspirational theft, as almost all of Luffy's attacks are taken from the animals that he spent time with on Rusukaina. Kongan, Leo Bazooka, Rhino Schneider, etc. But again, I would argue that this is another awakening step, and we are far from done here. Whole Cake Island would see the expansion of Gear 4th, quite literally in the case of Tank Man, a form achieved primarily through the act of eating far too many biscuits that one time. And you know what, that fight had one of the wackiest conclusions in the series. Cracker got literally stuck in Luffy's Haki fat and then just like, boom, bounced off into a building. It's like, it's such a childlike conclusion. Very Margin Boo logic of, haha, I'm so fat that you'll just bounce off me. And Tank Man is the third step of the Awakening Staircase, alongside the much more serious Snake Man, which in retrospect is the precursor step towards Gear 5th, as they are the most visually similar, and arguably the most free of all of the Gear 4th variations, due to the focus on speed, maneuverability, and the incorporation of higher level observation haki. This was the form that Luffy achieved as the solution to defeating Katakuri. And Tank Man, whilst more of a gag, was the exact same thing, a unique solution to beat Charlotte Cracker. And that's why the question of why Luffy didn't awaken against Katakuri is so easy to answer. Because he did. He awakened one step further along the staircase, and Snake Man was enough to put a full stop to the Katakuri situation. Now, if Katakuri had chosen to keep fighting, would Luffy have gone further? That's a much more difficult question to answer because we're still not quite sure what the exact trigger of Gear 5th was, but I would say no, and furthermore, here's why. Because Luffy was pushed to the breaking point by Kaido multiple times. The two most notable was when the fun Gear 5th stuff happened, but there was also once at the beginning of Wano, where Luffy was, for want of a better term, quite thoroughly Bellamy'd by Kaido. The same action happened in both situations, so why didn't Luffy awaken Gear 5th during Act 1? And I actually think the answer is kind of boring because I've already said it many times throughout this video, but it's because his physical abilities were still lagging behind his imagination. What Luffy did accomplish was a burst of unconscious Conqueror's Haki, showing that he still had the will to fight, but lacked the physical ability. However, during Wano, Luffy would go on to master Advanced Armament and Advanced Conqueror's Haki, which combined with the advanced observation gained from Whole Cake Island formed a potent menage a power within Luffy. So when the situation rolled around again and Luffy was knocked out, the will to continue fighting was matched by his newfound powers, and so Gear 5th was born, which then became step 4 on the Awakening Staircase, embodying every step to this point, made possible by Luffy continuing to push his physical and mental development through the sheer desire of imagination. There's also a very interesting evolution that you only really notice if you read the manga, and it's specifically in regards to the Gear Steam. With Gear 2nd, Oda colors it as regular white steam, however the Gear 4th steam has a bit of a purple hue to it, and the Snake Man steam adds on this orange rim, giving the steam an almost flame-like illusion, which is also helped by the increased sharpness of the steam. In the anime, everything is just plain white though, so it's hard to know how much, if any, investment we should be putting into that. But what this has made me realize is that Oda almost never draws Gear 4th in color. In fact, it's pretty much just those two volume covers and that's it. We also shouldn't ignore the Zoan properties of Luffy's fruit. As a Zoan user, he does inherit the animalistic nature of Nika, which becomes much more apparent in Gear 5th, as it has quite a radical effect on Luffy's personality. But getting there has been a very, very gradual process. There was no key moment like a Super Saiyan style transformation where Luffy went from one to the other, and in fact, every element of Gear 5th is something that Oda has been, I would say, painfully slowly drip feeding us over this shockingly long series. And that takes us to the big question of this video, which is, are we even at the top of the Awakening staircase yet, or are there still further steps to be taken? I mean, from a meta perspective, One Piece still isn't over yet. We still have a whole saga to go through, and Luffy's toughest fights are likely still ahead. So Luffy may still not yet be fully awakened, whatever fully awakened even means. In fact, it's entirely possible that there's no such thing as a full awakening, just more steps to be taken, governed entirely by the will and imagination of the fruit user in question. So please do let me know in the comments, what do you think Luffy's next step will be?